health, my career, and my reputation. Thankfully, those who actually know me knew all too well that the negative allegations of this magnitude must have been a sham from the beginning. This was another, and I mean another, attempt by our system to silence an intelligent and strong black man. This is especially true during a time when the same news media should be uplifting me for my accomplishments, should be uplifting our union. I've already lost 3 solid months where I should be doing speaking engagements as the 2024 Kentucky High School Teacher of the Year. But that time, I will never be able to get back. I want to thank my colleagues from Metro Government, from JCPS, especially Jefferson County Teachers Association, from the community who poured their love out and support for me and my family during these trying times. On September 13th last year, I received one of the greatest honors of my life. I was presented the 2024 Kentucky High School Teacher of the Year Award by Lieutenant Governor Jacqueline Coleman and the KDE Commissioner at the time, Dr. Jason Glass. And you already know 2023 was just an amazing year for me in general because I was on Metro Council, and that was an amazing experience. So it was very alarming for me to find out that the reason that I was reassigned is the same reason that I feel that I became the 2024 Kentucky High School Teacher of the Year. And I'm gonna keep saying I was a 2024 Kentucky High School Teacher of the Year because the media spent a whole lot of time adding other things that were unnecessary to that. A few stations said that my reassignment had something to do with me calling the old Commissioner Wayne Lewis a racist 5 years ago. I can assure you that my reassignment had absolutely nothing to do with Mr. Lewis. That case, like Mr. Lewis's career in Kentucky, has long passed, and thank God. No. My reassignment had to do with the fact that I'm against violence, and especially if that violence is perpetrated by a male towards a female. In my particular case, I saw 2 males attack a female, and I went to the female's rescue, and I removed the students off of the 2 males off of that female. The 2 students said that I removed them too harshly. But please understand that in the community or in school, anywhere I'm going, I will never allow a lady to be attacked by a male. So JCPS has a protocol to remove adults from the building when students make allegations, whether true or false. JCPS already said my case was unsubstantiated back in October, but EPSB, which is the organization that certifies educators, they don't meet until every other month. So they didn't hear my case till December, and I was notified last week that I would be returning back to school. Otherwise, I would have been back before Christmas break, and I should have been, especially with this educator shortage. This shines a light on many problems we have in this district. For one, there are many educators who are reassigned for frivolous reasons, and we need them in this extreme educator shortage. And honestly, I can't help but notice that many of the folks reassigned are people of color. This leads me to questions such as the following. One, why are educators of color disciplined at higher rates than their counterparts? This is a problem that has never been addressed, but really needs to be part of a national conversation. Two, is there a different process JCPS and EPSB can use that doesn't keep educators out of the classroom for so long? Three, what are some protective measures we can take to protect educators from frivolous allegations? Four, what accountability should be added to those who falsify stories to manipulate the system and do serious damage to one's career and reputation? Now, let me stop on that last statement real quick, because as a racial and social justice activist, please don't misinterpret my words to say that Kumar Rashad says we need to punish young folks for lying. That's not what I'm saying at all. I'm against punishment being used as an incentive, like when the state legislator voted to kick kids out of school last year. But what we do need is an accountability system that allows young folks to be mentored more and to have more mental health counselors so they feel comfortable relying on the truth and that truth alone. I'm very excited to continue my role in the classroom where I make the most difference, as recognized by my 2024 Kentucky High School Teacher of the Year Award, and my future endeavors as the next vice president of Jefferson County Teachers Association. I thank you all for listening, and I am open to any questions that you may have.
So you have been cleared by JCPS to return to the classroom?
Yes, sir. I'll be in class tomorrow.
Just to make sure we're all clear, all on the same page, the incident that had you reassigned was you saw two male students attacking a female student. Was that at Breckenridge Metro?
Yes, ma'am.
And you went to remove the students and they filed the complaint?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
That's exactly what happened. Yes,
and
something like that, you know, if it was any other person, it wouldn't have made the news, but because it's Kumar Rashad, then it's a big deal. But I truly implore you all to, you know, that story went on for about a whole month, and they put my story next to these stories of other educators who were doing some malicious things. And that put in people's mind that I'm doing malicious things, which made me guilty in the public eye without any evidence. So I'm imploring you all to make sure that this story reaches that same amount of magnitude, because what happened to me should be restored by you all.
When you were reassigned, did you have to take a pay cut at all, or was your pay the same?
It was the same. They just didn't want me, you know, when they do that, they don't want the educator around kids at that point. So they just move you keep the same pay until this whole thing gets cleared up. And for me, it was rather quickly, where others have been in the system for about 6 months to even a year.
You said there are similar situations like the one you went through with reassignment. Does that mean there are currently other teachers you think are unjustly reassigned at the moment?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I feel like, I've met a lot of them, a few of them through this process, and I definitely feel that there are others. I definitely don't feel like I'm the only one. I know I'm not the only one, so. Yeah, you're right.
So have they offered any compensation or any services for your catcher being demeaned?
No.
No.
Any of that? No. Restore. This is the only step of restorative justice that I'm getting is these ladies and gentlemen in front of me. The district has no plan or no action to amend the wrongs that have been perpetrated towards me. That's not even part of their protocol, but it should be. You're right.
So are there anything in place, not just for yourself, but any other teacher that has went down this path, that has had allegations and things like this, that, you know, your mental state, your mental capacity?
Mm-hmm.
So there's never been any compensation?
No. No compensation, although our insurance does allow us to seek help from mental health counselors in a limited capacity. This course is not, you know, just offered. It's just offered part of the district package. But as far as for me myself, I've had to really divest myself into reading books, especially one by, what's it called? It's called Invisible Ache by... what's her husband's name?
Courtney Vance.
Thank you, Courtney Vance. And reading that book and it really helped me out and really just helped me deal with this mental health part. Because when you go through that and you know you've been accused falsely and you know that people are saying so many negative things about you, and a couple of weeks before, I had just been celebrated as a Kentucky Teacher of the Year. So that was the highest point of my life. And then to go from that roller coaster to what is the lowest point of my life is very difficult. It's very difficult. But I'm so fortunate I have folks that have my back that have really looked out for me and kept me sane and stable, because it's a rough patch that many folks have gone through. And when you got to go back into the classroom, you know, a lot of folks don't have the preparation that I tried to give myself before I come back in the classroom. So, yeah, we definitely thank you for the questions, because we absolutely need to address that situation, because, you know, teachers are human beings too.
You mentioned earlier that race might have been a part of this. The students who were involved, were they black, white? And are you talking about the two students who filed a complaint against you, or are you talking about JCPS and the reassignment being partially based on race?
I think reassignment is partially based on race. I also believe that a lot of the power and control, a lot of the power and control of some of these situations really comes from the principal involved. So if the principal's on your team, sometimes you won't reach this point of reassignment. But the principal's not on your team, you're going to hit there. You're going to get her some reassignment. So a lot of, and I do feel that race has played a factor of the many attacks I've had from this district towards me and my character. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about the sorry?
No, but it didn't have anything to do with the race of the students.
You know, race of the students, two were black, one was white. So that's what, so no, I'm not talking about racism from the students. I love all my students. When I'm talking about racism, I'm talking about from administrators, whether they're school administrators or right here behind me. Yeah, those are the problems that need to be addressed because, you know, educators of color make up a very small number. So if you're trying to look at some proportion numbers and then you see, hold on, man, why are educators of color being disciplined so much or being reassigned so much? There's a problem. Racism can be identified by its intent or its effect. And then in this case, it's definitely the effect. Yes, sir. Come here, Muhammad. I got this is my student, Muhammad. He's one of the ones who nominated me for Kentucky Teacher of the Year. He's graduated last year, and I invited him to come up here, man. Is he allowed to say something? He can say something. Say something.
How are you guys doing today?
What do you teach?
I teach mathematics and a course called Developing Black Historical Conscience.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's the best teacher I've had since I started school, since I started kindergarten. He's always been the realest man to me. He's always been, you know, a role model to all the students, not just me. And he's always making sure every single student gets the same amount of respect as any other student. You know what I mean? He don't discriminate against one person, show favoritism to this person. He's loving towards all, man. He's a great teacher.
Thank you, bro.
Oh, yeah.
What has it been like since he's been on reassignment?
He graduated. He's not there now. Mm-hmm. He graduated last year.
I have a quick question. Mr. Rashad, do you feel as if that maybe, I know you said that race played a part, but have you ever thought about possibly you being a threat? You know, especially with you moving up to the next capacity of what you was trying to, just, you know, you being a threat as a strong black man.
Oh, absolutely. I know a lot of people, you know, some people who don't want to see a black male thrive are threatened. You know, I've had situations where I know that I'm a threat because I've been written up for frivolous things. I've been written up for putting too much paper in the paper copier. I've been written up for taking my kids on a field trip after the principal already approved the field trip. You know, written up for, you can get this from EPSB. Written up for supposedly interfering with the SBDM elections, but the EPSB found that the principal interfered with the SBDM elections. You see what I'm saying? And this is just the constant racism that we face that others don't face in this district every day.
So if you had conversations with JCPS, you're talking about restorative justice.
Mm-hmm.
Have you spoken with them about your dissatisfaction with the way this process was carried out, and what was their response?
I mentioned to a couple of board members. I haven't gotten a response from either of the board members who I relayed this information to. Some of them actually got this whole entire speech before today and haven't responded. So, you know, I've sent out some warnings, definitely. In October, but
was that a determination made by who?
That was made by the district. Compliance and investigation does all the investigations. Compliance and investigation said it was unsubstantiated in October. By then, EPSB had already met in October, or it would be too soon for them to hear my case. And like I said, EPSB only meets for those cases every other month. So after October, they're not meeting again until December. And I get the email, the clearance, what I call my freedom papers, last week.
And so does JCPS have to wait?
Yes, JCPS has to wait for clearance for EPSB. The state has to come in and take control in these matters.
And
yeah.
They've already given clearance even though they haven't met until December?
See that? Okay, let me clarify. Yeah, compliance and investigation says that I'm clear that those charges are unsubstantiated. They said that about me, but then they have to submit their whole investigation to EPSB. They have to go through that paperwork, verify this and that, come back and say, okay, yeah, we agree with them.
Okay, I got you.
So goes okay. to the JCPS investigation, then it goes to the state, and the state signs off on it.
Yes. So we're talking about absolutely.
Can you just talk about what goes into the investigation? You know, were you interviewed? Were the students interviewed?
Oh, yeah. Everyone's interviewed. I'm interviewed. I have an initial interview by myself. Actually, what happens is I write a statement. I send a statement. They schedule me for an interview. They might schedule me for a clarification interview after that as well. And then once they go on an investigation, they come into school and they talk to any educator or person or student or educator who is familiar with my situation. And they just run an extensive interview. Just a lot of interviews. And once they do all the interviews of everybody, they wrap up the case, they bring me back in, they tell me unsubstantiated, we gotta wait for EPSB to sign off of it, and then you should be able to go back into class.
And just to be clear, you're not criticizing the actual investigation that took
place? I'm criticizing the investigation in the sense that it shouldn't take this long. You know, EPSB need to streamline this process so that they are getting people out of there every single month, not to every other month. Because there's so many folks waiting to get back in these school buildings that love these kids and need to be there. These kids need to see us there, and they're not because EPSB has 2 months in between, you know, every other month. That's too long because there's way, you know, you think about all the teachers across the state, there's so many of them that us they have to deal with. They need to be meeting every month, and I would say bi-monthly. Oh, tomorrow's going to be nothing but love, man. I know my students miss me. I know my colleagues miss me. I miss them. And it's just going to be a happy reunion. You know, it's going to be a happy reunion, like a military father that's come back. You know, that's how that's going to feel like, you know? I have no idea because when I leave, they make me sign a paper that says I'm not allowed to talk to anybody at the school. Or the parents of the students at the school. So I have no idea. And then once I leave, they cut me off of all emails and, you know, correspondence. So, you know, my email has been way less, so that's good.
Reassigned to
Blue Lick East compound. Yeah. Good people out there, really nice. And I got a time to really do a lot of self-reflection.
What were your duties while you were there?
Funny. duties, just to be there.
Wow.
Be there. And if they needed something, then maybe, but they never needed anything. So, but it's not really a dutiful place. It's just really a place that they just want to tuck educators away. If you want to compare it to like an educator jail, yeah, that's what I would compare it to, an educator jail, because you have, it's just a lot of isolation. And you're made to feel like you're guilty until proven innocent.
Kumar, would you think the due process has been weaponized to sort of make the words of innocent until proven guilty as hollow as words of all men?
All men are created equal. How funny is that? Yeah, that's what the Constitution says. We're supposed to believe it, but it's, you know, society doesn't act that way, and you're right. You know, due process is manipulated because if anyone just makes any claim, false or otherwise, then you've just put damage on someone's career reputation. But at the same time, when it's time for this person to return, there's no news about that. So I'm doing this here for all those who were like me, who were reassigned and not given fair treatment, or just reassigned based off of frivolous calls, like I was given off of frivolous accusations, and who are sitting there waiting week after week, day after day, month after month, in order to get back to serving these kids that we love.